Good morning students, here we start with the gross enrollment lecture of the horizontal disposition of peritoneum above the transverse colon. Now here our layer will be, our stage will be above the level of epiploic foramen. In the last lecture we had studied the horizontal disposition of the peritoneum at the level of epiploic foramen. Now horizontal disposition of peritoneum above the level of epiploic foramen, which is very interesting, very important. Here horizontal disposition once again, but this will be above the level of epiploic foramen. Now, as usual, we draw over here. This is the cross section. Here we draw the cross section of the trunk. Now, this is the transverse section, cross section of the trunk. This is the anterior abdominal wall, then the lateral abdominal wall, same way anterior and the lateral abdominal wall, and this is the posterior abdominal wall. Now here, deep inside, first we draw all the cross sections of the important viscera. So by now we are knowing that the important viscera would be, first of all, it would be the lever. This is the important viscera, and here in this lever we draw this ligamentum venosum notch. This is the fissure of ligamentum venosum which we have to draw over here, and after drawing this fissure we draw this border of the lever. Now after drawing this lever we will then draw over here at some distance the stomach over here. So let us draw the cross section of the stomach, and then just on the left margin we should be drawing the spleen. So this is the cross section of the spleen. After that we will show on the left hand side, we will show the kidney. So this will be the left kidney, cross section of the left kidney, and then we are going to draw the lines, the reflection of the peritoneum. After drawing these sections, of course here I will write this as lever, we are going to draw the entire lining of the horizontal reflection of the peritoneum above the level of epiploic foramen, which is very interesting. Now we start with, from the anterior abdominal wall the parietal peritoneum will be reflected back on the lever as bilaminar fold, sickle shaped fold, which is called falciform ligament, which we know very well. So therefore we start with this green color as parietal peritoneum. From the anterior abdominal wall we start as falciform ligament which is reflected on the lever. So from the hepatic attachment of the falciform ligament, that is from anterior abdominal wall, on the right side, on the right side, from the hepatic attachment of this falciform ligament, this entire peritoneum will cover the anterior surface and the right lateral surface of the right lobe of lever. So this parietal peritoneum will be covering the anterior surface and the right lateral surface of the right lobe of lever. Yes, this is the proper, these are the proper words. Then we know that we have seen in the posterior inferior surface of lever, this peritoneum will be reflected as the right triangular ligament at the apex of the bare area of lever. If you recollect that diagram, in order to make you understand, here we come across the apex of the right triangular ligament, where my hand, where my finger is there. Now, very short understanding, please come on this side. Now, this is a very, very short understanding. Now, here, supposing this is the posterior inferior surface of lever, very fast understanding. Here we have shown superior layer of coronary ligament, then the right triangular ligament, the inferior layer of coronary ligament, and then this inferior layer of coronary ligament on the left hand side, it will form the left edge of the inferior vena cava. So here there is disposition of inferior vena cava, and also at the same time this will form the right side of the lobe, and here there will be the presence of the caudate lobe above and caudate lobe below. So therefore now this will become the right margin of caudate lobe, the inferior layer of coronary ligament, as it is reflected, it becomes the right margin of caudate lobe. So this is the caudate lobe, and below we know there will be gallbladder. At this level there will be the gallbladder as well as the ligamentum teres. So in between there will be the presence of caudate lobe, and over here to complete this, this will be the fissure of ligamentum venosum and porta hepatis. Now, after understanding this posterior inferior surface of liver, this is the bare area which is present on the posterior surface of the right lobe of the liver. And this bare area is formed by superior layer of coronary ligament, inferior layer of coronary ligament, and this is the right triangular ligament. This portion is the right triangular ligament. Now, and we know that this is the complete reflection of the peritoneum. So therefore, our peritoneum, which we are reflecting, is coming at this side, that is the right triangular ligament. And this right triangular ligament, along with on this side, there will be this left triangular ligament. This will be the left triangular ligament. So this left triangular ligament, as well as the right triangular ligament, they will serve as important attachments of the left lobe as well as the right lobe of liver with the diaphragm. That is why we need to understand this. So our peritoneum, which we are reflecting, is present at this level, right triangular ligament, and then it is reflected to the diaphragm. From here it will be reflected to the diaphragm. So therefore, from right triangular ligament, as it is reflected to diaphragm, please come on this side. Same way, this is the same peritoneum. It is lining the anterior surface and the lateral surface of the right lobe of the liver, and then at this level it will join, or it will function as right triangular ligament, the apex of the bare area of the liver. That right triangular ligament we have seen over there, it will function as the apex of the bare area of the liver. From here, this peritoneum, now here we need to mention at this point that this will form the right triangular ligament. So this is the right triangular ligament. Peritoneum, we are tracing the right side of the peritoneum covering the anterior surface of the right lobe and the lateral surface of the right lobe of liver, and it has reached till the right triangular ligament. From here it will be reflected to the diaphragm, and that reflection we show like this. This is the point of reflection to the diaphragm. This is, remember, it is a cross section, transfer section above the level of epiploid foramen. So therefore we are tracing on the right hand side, the right side of the parietal peritoneum, since it started from the right side of the falciform ligament covering on the right side and then till the right triangular ligament. From here it is reflected to the diaphragm. From the diaphragm, once again it will be reflected back on the anterolateral abdominal wall. This point is very important. So here, see here, from the diaphragm it is reflected once again back on the anterolateral body wall, and then it will join the right side of the falciform ligament. So this complete tracing of the parietal peritoneum is of right side, present in front of the right lobe of the liver, including the right triangular ligament, its reflection on the diaphragm, and then back again from diaphragm it is reflected to the anterolateral abdominal wall. Again it will join to the right margin of falciform ligament. So one side, the entire parietal peritoneum lining we have understood, and this horizontal parietal lining, horizontal disposition of the parietal peritoneum, is above the level of epiploid foramen, above the level of epiploid foramen on the right hand side. After understanding this, we start with left hand side. So before that, first let me mark this as falciform ligament. Now let me start on the left hand side. On the left hand side, the left layer of falciform ligament will be reflected and cover the anterior surface of the left lobe of liver, anterior surface of left lobe of liver. Then it will cover the posterior surface of the left lobe of the liver, posterior surface of left lobe of liver. Then it will cover inferior surface of the left lobe of liver, inferior surface of left lobe of liver, Remember, these are the important words. Anterior surface, posterior surface, inferior surface. Anterior surface, the posterior and inferior surface of left lobe of liver. And then, now comes the most important point. It will be present, it will be reflecting, or it will be continuous in the left lip and the left wall of fissure of ligamentum venosum. This is the fissure of ligamentum venosum. And it will be continuous with the left lip and left wall of the fissure of ligamentum venosum. So here, let me mark this simple, this structure over here as fissure of ligamentum venosum. This is what I have marked, fissure of ligamentum venosum. We have reached the parietal peritoneum. We have reached, after reflecting on these structures, on these portions of the liver, we have reached to the left lip and left wall of fissure of ligamentum venosum. Then it will reach the floor. Here it reaches the floor of ligamentum venosum. This is where it will reach the floor. From the floor of ligamentum venosum, it will be reflected back. Once again, it is reflected back and it will form the anterior layer of, here it forms the anterior layer of lesser omentum. So here it becomes the anterior layer of lesser omentum, because the same peritoneum from the floor of fissure of ligamentum venosum, which is present on liver, is reflected back as anterior layer of lesser omentum till the lesser curvature of stomach. From the lesser curvature of stomach, remember it is a horizontal disposition, horizontal tracing, very interesting. From the anterior layer of lesser omentum till the lesser curvature of stomach, from here it will cover the anterior-inferior surface of stomach. This is the anterior-inferior surface of stomach in cross section. From here, see how interesting it gets. From the anterior-inferior surface of stomach, then it will pass to the, it is reflected to the anterior lip of the hilum of the spleen. As it is reflected to the anterior lip of hilum of spleen, which we have seen yesterday in the horizontal disposition at the level of apical foramen, which layer it becomes? Here it will form anterior layer of gastrosplenic ligament, where my finger is there. So it is reflected on the anterior lip of the hilum of spleen as anterior layer of gastrosplenic ligament. This we have seen when we discussed horizontal disposition at the level of epiploic foramen. This is above the level of epiploic foramen, but this reflection will remain the same. So here I can mention this as anterior layer of gastrosplenic ligament, which we have discussed yesterday. And then the same peritoneum, it will be continuous, it will completely invest the entire spleen, cover the entire spleen, it will invest the entire spleen and pass on to the posterior lip. Here it passes till the posterior lip of the hilum of the spleen, from where it is reflected to the anterior surface of the left kidney. And as it is reflected to anterior surface of left kidney, it becomes which layer? This also we have seen yesterday in the horizontal disposition at the level of apical foramen. It will continue as posterior layer of leno-renal ligament. So here we can mark this as posterior layer of leno-renal ligament. See how interesting it is. So here it will continue as posterior layer of leno-renal ligament till the anterior surface of left kidney, from where it will then be reflected to the anterolateral, this is the body wall, it will be reflected to the posterolateral body wall, then it will cover the lateral body wall, and then it will cover the anterolateral body wall till the level of where it will join the left layer of falciform ligament. So here we are joining back. So this, we have completed the entire tracing of the peritoneum of the greater sac, parietal peritoneum, on the left hand side. We started with the left layer of falciform ligament from the left lobe of liver covering its surfaces, then the left lip and the left wall of the fissure of ligamentum venosum, then the floor of ligamentum venosum, then it becomes the anterior layer of lesser omentum, covering the anterior inferior surface of stomach, then it becomes the anterior layer of gastrosplenic ligament, investing the entire spleen, then it becomes the posterior layer of leonorenal ligament, and then it will continue as anterolateral body wall, it will line the anterolateral body wall till the left layer of falciform ligament. Very simple, very interesting. With the help of this diagram, you can make your concepts very clear, very simple, and you can understand it better. So this is how we have completed the right side as well as the left side of the lining of parietal peritoneum above the epiploic foramen. Remember, still we are yet to be completed. This much we have lined about the parietal peritoneum regarding the greater sac. This is above the epiploic foramen. Now what we need to show is, to complete this diagram, we will show over here the presence of, at this point, inferior vena cava. And at this point, we will show in the posterior abdominal wall the presence of aorta. Now the last structure that is left, very important, is the entire omental bursa, that is the lesser sac. The entire lesser sac, remember, since this is above the level of epiploic foramen, so it will be completed on all the sides. For example, if I draw with yellow color, this omental bursa will cover, it will function as the posterior layer of lesser omentum here, covering the posterior inferior surface of stomach. Then it is continuous as which layer? The posterior layer of gastrosplenic ligament, where my finger is there. And then it will continue as the anterior layer of leonorenal ligament. These two points also we have discussed elaborately in our previous lecture, that is horizontal section of the parietal peritoneum at the level of epiploic foramen, we know this. So this is the omental bursa or the lining of lesser sac. Then it will cover the posterior abdominal wall, and then it will cover the entire omental bursa. So it is a closed cavity. Now remember, this is above the level of epiploic foramen, above the level of epiploic foramen. So therefore here, we should write this as lesser sac, or either lesser sac or omental bursa. So now the last segment will be this. This is known as the lesser omentum. So after marking lesser omentum, our entire diagram is complete. This is how you have to understand the horizontal disposition of peritoneum above the level of epiploic foramen. Now coming up in our next segment is horizontal disposition of peritoneum between epiploic foramen and the root of transverse mesocolon. That will be in the next segment. Thank you very much.